Thank you, Ava. Good afternoon, Secretary Mr. Pandey, my colleague, ladies and gentlemen. This is a very special session, not only just the almost the last session of the day, but extremely important given the current situation. We are especially thankful to Secretary Deepam for taking the time out to do the session for us, because he has been for some time, and just started attending office, and despite that, he agreed to do the session for us. So, sir, a special thank you to you for doing this session. I must say that we are in a very safe hands now, given your background, kind of finance handle. This is a very critical push, and this is something which deals with the market directly, and you have a great understanding of that. So we are absolutely in a good and safe hands. Try to do a little bit of some gatherings before setting up this session. I think people would want to hear three things, and Rasesh will set the tone. We got a lot of feedback on three areas which people to hear your inputs on. One, the announcement which happened as a Atmanirbhar Bharat with regard to strategic disinvestment, the privatization in terms of strategic area and the non-strategic area. There was a very clear articulation of the strategy. So the progress on that. Number two, in the budget earlier year, the budget was presented in a different environment. There was a target set out for privatized disinvestment, 2.1 lakh. What's your view on it? And the third, currently there's a significant liquidity, not just in India, but globally. And the government can take advantage of this liquidity by increasing the supply. This morning, this point Rashes had made that we need to increase more supply into the market to increase, to absorb this liquidity which is there in the market. So the government has any plans for that? Why don't I invite Rasesh to make his opening comments, and I'll invite the Secretary to share his views and thoughts. Over to you, Rasesh.
Thank you, Sunil, and good afternoon to all of you. And it's a great privilege to host Mr. Pandey, Secretary Deepam, and I think all of us know that he has got not only his plate full, but I think his plate is overflowing with the amount of things that have to be done. And in the last 8 months since Mr. Pandey has taken over this role, I had the opportunity to work closely with him. And I still remember it was only about 5 days after you had joined, after you had taken over as Secretary Deepam. And we were on the roadshow for Bharat Bond first tranche in Singapore. And there was an apprehension about, whether you will be willing to do that or not, because you were just about 4 or 5 days into the role. But with all enthusiasm and gutso, you dived into that, and the way you were able to explain the product to the investors and explain the concept behind it was marvelous to watch. To see somebody who just taken over a portfolio and go so deeply and so well into that was a marvelous act to watch. And after that, we have seen how you galvanized all the government departments, all the approvals, RBI, everybody else in getting the Bharat Bond first tranche done. And I think after you took over the Deepam Secretary, this was one of the early things that you had to do, and it was great to work with you and have that opportunity. And obviously over the last few months we worked together on Bharat Bond 2 also. So I've been a big admirer at the pace at which you move. I think you can put a lot of us in the private sector to shame with the aggressiveness and the sense of purpose that you bring to the department. And I think this Deepam has been a fairly big game changer. I remember a few years ago when it was still Department of Disinvestment. And I think from there, the renaming and the repurposing of this department has also been marvelous, because I think government obviously has a lot of PSU units. And rather than have a disinvestment mindset, which is just to sell assets to bridge the gap in the budget or raise some funds for the government, I think an active asset management purpose which has been there, and I think it was in the last few years that has come about. But under your leadership, I think DIPAM has really taken the role of being truly an asset manager of government assets, not just a disinvestment to raise money. And that is marvelous to watch, because I think our economy, government plays a big role, government companies play a big role in our economy, and the more efficiently they are managed, the more efficiently they are capitalized, the more they can also come to the public market, because the stamp of the government and the quality of a lot of these government companies is marvelous. So for the retail investors, putting faith into them, not just in equity but in bond market, have been great to watch. So first of all, thanks from all of us in the capital markets for the leadership that you provided, that you continue to provide, because we do feel that DIPAM is also going to be a key player in the capital markets. I think whether it's equity markets or bond markets, DIPAM will also shape how investors react to new products, innovation, all of that. I know that you're going to have a very hectic year ahead of you, in spite of COVID and all. COVID obviously has been a big game changer, but we have seen that you have not allowed the pace to slow down. And that is going to be, I think, the harbinger of things to come in this year. Obviously, everybody's eyes, sir, is on the Air India disinvestment, because Air India has been one big objective for the government to get in a private sector or a foreign investor into that and revive that airline, which has been a big national asset. But along with that, the finance minister, honorable finance minister, has also announced the IPO for LIC, which I'm sure is going to be one big complex a project at your table, and we are all eagerly waiting for that also to unfold in the coming year, because LIC IPO, a lot of us believe, will make LIC one of the largest capitalization companies in India, and could be a big catalyst for again reviving a lot of retail investment in the equity markets in India. Along with that, I think the Bharat bond success has been a big feather in your cap, and now that the total corpus of both Bharat bond 1 and 2 has crossed 25,000 crore, it itself is a big achievement in this time where everybody is conserving liquidity for the kind of response that has come for Bharat bond. I think the bond ETFs, especially for government companies, but also it's an innovation for all of us in capital markets, because we do realize that the next phase of capital markets has to be beyond equity markets. It has to be bond markets. We have to go from equity market oriented capital market to bond market also, because as the needs of the economy, especially for long-term investments, are getting developed, a very good and robust bond market could be a good way to start. And the Bharat bond ETF has been a good example of what kind of retail appetite is there if we can create the right products for them. Outside of that, I think all of our eyes are on the bank consolidation. Government has indicated that they might not have more than 4 or 5 PSU banks. You have already done some consolidation of the banks by merging smaller banks with larger banks, but I'm sure that is also going to be the agenda, and all of us would love to hear from you on what your thoughts are and how you go about, because the banking industry is the backbone of the Indian economy, and the way the PSU bank, which is even now almost 2/3 of the banking industry, the shape it takes is going to affect all of us in the coming years. So we would love to hear your views on that. And finally, some kind of a roadmap for the long-term plan for DIPAM. Because as we said earlier, DIPAM is not just about raising resources for the government, for the budgetary needs, but it's also about efficiently utilizing the public sector entities, the public sector resources we have, whether it's resources inside the companies or the companies themselves. And we would love to hear your views on what your thoughts are on a medium-term basis of how DIPAM will evolve and what the priorities for DIPAM would be, because that would help all of us also align our resources and our focus and our attention to aligning with your priorities, so that we can bring the strength of the capital market to your objectives at DIPAM also. So along with that, sir, a warm welcome to you. And thank you very much for gracing this part of the conference. The capital market conference for FICCI is a very important one, because here is where we get all the thought leadership into play, and your session is going to add a lot more color to the evolution of capital markets in the coming years. Thank you very much, sir, for being here.
Sir, may I invite you to make your comments, please?
Thank you very much, FICCI, for inviting me to the 17th annual Capital Market Conference. Thank you, Mr. Sunil Sanghai, Chairman FICCI National Committee on Capital Markets. Thank you, Mr. Rajesh Shah, for kind words. It's a very good opportunity to interact with the investors, and particularly, you know, during the COVID time, this medium, which VC is a good medium. We have been exploring it to the government, and we have been working actually in the government to these VCs, and I think a lot of things can be done. Although we would like, you know, the physical meetings, you know, the interaction, the feel could be different. But then I think we are resilient people. Indians are resilient, and I think and that's the way to go in living with COVID. Now, let me just begin by saying that, you know, just a snapshot of, you know, last 5 years of this government. You know, disinvestment was given a lot of priority. In the 6 years that this government was there, the 3.29 lakh crores were raised through disinvestment. Just to give you a comparison, between 2004 and 14, only 1 lakh crore was raised, largely through the minority stake sale. But this was in 5 years' time, it was more than double. So, you know, while, you know, the average annual was during that period was about 10,000 to 11,000 crore per annum, this average jumped to 55,000 crore per annum during the last 6 years. So we have done a lot in the last 6 years, and that also throws up its own unique challenges that I will also come to. Second part we have done, as Ms. Rajesh mentioned, that we have actually, we were known as Department of Disinvestment. We changed into 2016 as DIPAM, Department of Investment and Public Asset Management, with a realization that we need to also create value. We need to look at the capital management. So it's not merely selling shares. That is our job. And the government recognized it. So to some extent, that was a paradigm shift. However, I would say that although we would like it to be, but still the media and lots of investors still think ourselves to be actually a disinvesting ministry or a department rather than a capital management department. So I think we need to have more in terms of engagement with the stakeholders to make them realize that we are more than just disinvestment. Just to give you an example, the dividend payout ratio during the last 5 years was 15.4% higher as compared to last year. So we have looked at, you know, how the you know, there should be consistent dividend policies of the PSUs going forward, and we also looked at, you know, various other issues like bonus shares, like buybacks, which were not there earlier. And those are the kind of things which have got focus. Another important thing, we have brought in the strategic disinvestment into revival. You know, in the UPA government, the strategic disinvestment was shelved. So practically, if you really look at it, the last bit of strategic disinvestments were in the then NDA government during the 2000-2004 period. And thereafter, there has been none, but it was revived by the NDA government. And we have completed 8 transactions in the last 3 years, you know, yielding about 66,000 crores. So it's almost like, $8 to $9 billion worth of strategic disinvestment has taken place. But I admit that most of it was within the public sector space and not in the privatization space. And so therefore, I will come to how we are shifting now gears into the new territory, and in our view, a very important territory of privatization. We've added two instruments, the Bharat 22 ETF, CPSC ETF, raised about 86,000 crores, and which led to a lot of supply of shares, which were not earlier available in the capital markets. Of course, the downside is that, we have also, to some extent, some oversupplies, in which case the public sector, shares have also remained depressed. One of the reasons could be, our excessive supply in some cases. So we need to also look at fine-tuning that strategy so that we have an orderly development of capital markets, and as also the availability of the shares, so that we don't have, we don't shortchange the long-term investors and their interest, and their interest in the capital market is also kept in use of as a PSU stocks. Listing of CPSCs was another major initiative because unless and until you list, you don't unlock the value and you don't increase the public accountability of the CPSC, you don't improve management, because listing actually gives you a lot of, it forces you to do a lot of undertake measures which you otherwise won't do. And so therefore 13 CPSCs were listed in the last 13 years. And the current market cap of these 13 listed CPSCs is now close to 1.43 lakh crore. So that's the kind of market cap was added. So it was not there earlier. And we will have an important agenda of continuing to list those listable entities which are good, which meet with the SEBI criteria, which in any case, we have to, sort of bring them on board to the market. And of course, the launch of Bharat Bond ETF, which was, as Mr. Ashish Shah mentioned, a joint venture with Edelweiss, where we were able to weave out, I would say, a reasonably good product, bringing in liquidity, and also giving access to the retail markets. At the same time, giving fair amount of security for the fixed income group. They could, if you would actually hold on to the bonds, ETFs, you can have an YTN, you can have a fairly stable return. But at the same time, if you were, should you be wanting to get out of that market, you have market which is supportive, you have liquidity available in the market through market makers, and then you have AMC to support wherever you have a need for redemption. And 3.5 to 4 crore of daily trading volume. It is much more than even GSEC. So, I mean, it's a very limited window yet, but the moment we expand this market consistently, adding more bonds, more series, we have got 4 bond, 2023, 25, 2030, 2031, and we create the rest of the thing so that we create a full ladder structure where you have bonds availability of all maturities in a very limited ISIN, so therefore tradability increases, and that is how we intend to deepen the market so far as PSU bonds are concerned, bringing more PSU bonds into it, have more regular issuance to this instrument also within that regular issuance within the same ISIN. So we would like to put our contribution, and we'll encourage other private ETFs also to come on board with new products, and they can come out new products, new bond ETFs can actually come to the market seeing the success of this one. These, of course, were there, and now we had, the second issue was actually strategic disinvestment, that we had actually a big target. As I said, pre-COVID in the budget, and we were pretty sanguine about it. The reason was that we had change in strategic management strategy. One, as I was said, that focusing on privatization. Because what we feel is that privatization will bring real benefits in terms of operational efficiency, in terms of growth and momentum to the economy. There are public sector available in large sectors, and if suppose private sector to come, some of the constraints of capital would be taken care of, technological infusion, management practices, so many benefits of privatization can actually come into play. But now the privatization, earlier some of the strategic disinvestment we have been trying, the choice of the units which we initially thought was maybe not appropriate, very much appropriate, because if we are really trying to sell a sick company with old technology, and then we are also not having any non-core assets of assets also bundled into it, so it's not really a very viable proposition, because greenfield is wide open also to the private sector, and they may not be interested in getting into those kind of projects unless and until they see value. So we have seen some of our strategic disinvestment not succeeding, but there are many of them where we have looked at, we have changed the process. It was very important. I mean, one of the important thing is that investor engagement, that when we are trying to now sell the strategic disinvestment, privatization or strategic disinvestment, we engage with investors, which we were not doing it earlier. We were rather, secluded. So what we have now, recently we have added an engagement process prior to the expression of interest, in which we are able to actually work out reasonable concerns of the investors within our own expression of interest. Because if your EOI is out, and if you know that the investors are looking at it, and we have met with certain concerns while drafting the terms and conditions of EOI, that makes it much easier for them to come in and also then engage further in our SPAs, etc., in the data room. But the initial thing, which was earlier we were secluded from the investors, that change in process we have made effect recently. And then that has led to a situation where we are able to know the investor's mind. And going forward, I would say that our strategic disinvestment will be more successful, both in terms of choice of the units that we go for, secondly, investor engagement in drafting out conditions, and third, in terms of also speeding up the process. But the whole issue, I think you have to look at pre-COVID and post-COVID. Now, of course, there is a lot of liquidity in the market even post-COVID, because a lot of central banks around the world have opened their stimulus packages, money is going around, people are looking for returns, But what kind of thing? Now, strategic disinvestment is a long-term commitment of the investors. It requires a lot of deep engagement. And normally, a strategic disinvestment process takes around 8 to 9 months because you have to go expression of interest, and then you have to go deep down. They look at the assets. They might need site visits, because you are coming into the management control. So it's not merely investing in the market as a minority shareholder of a well-established and sought-after company. Even if the company is well-established and sought-after, if the management is to be taken over, the people, investors, would go into every contract, they would look at every possibility, everything, before they actually set to their valuations. So therefore, it's a time-taking process. Now, I think to a lot of extent, the COVID has put a brake on this, because travel, international travel is virtually stopped. The people are not able to move. And although many things are possible through VCs, but there are areas, so far as the strategic disinvestment is concerned, where they would like travel to be necessary. So to some extent, we had to grant extensions to some of the EOIs that we issued. And it was basically not that the investors are not engaged, but they want more time. Because one thing which is not open yet is international travel. And that leads us to me also some of the questions that were raised initially about Air India. And we were very, we actually restructured the EOI of Air India with a very deep sense of responsibility that we would actually be successful this time. And so therefore, a lot of debt restructuring was done, a lot of rationality was brought down in for the balance sheet, and a lot of decisions, a lot of concerns of the investors were met in the EOI. So it was not really a lack of effort on our part. But unfortunately, the COVID has actually led to a situation where travel market is in a very big uncertainty. And so therefore, I mean, there are domestic travel to some extent has picked up, international travel, regular international travel is still not on. So therefore, people are waiting and watching, and I think we'll have to, you know, hold on to it. We'll have to, I would say, persist and persevere in these transactions. So I'm not really looking at, now, if you look at the COVID, of course, the budget things, the revenue situation, the other situations undergo a sea change because the economy is not back to usual. We are still talking of reductions, reduction in our GDP, you know, in this year. So therefore, you know, but what I'm presenting here view is not really a 1 year's view, because we should not be really looking at next 6-7 months of only post-COVID, but also look at beyond. What is the direction which is being set? Because we will get over COVID sooner or later. We will move into a higher thing. And then the direction still will need to be set so that the people make up their minds. And therefore, so it's not really a parking of the liquidity which is just temporarily come. That can only happen if you have a very good companies where people are, a lot of people are interested in looking at. And I think through FPI route and so on, they can come in and take a share. But in terms of strategic disinvestments, we have to have a deep engagement with investors. And we have to persist and persevere with the investors. But I'm sure that we will certainly see the light of the day on privatization that we have been waiting for. Now, coming to the future policy, what FM announced is basically trying to bring clarity and trying to bring direction. We have been doing, as I said, in November 2019, for the first time, we choose some of the profit-making large organizations where the investor interest was there and decided to go for strategic decisions. So it was, you know, a change of tack, change of strategy, not from totally loss-making, from, you know, problematic companies relatively, to companies which are really doing very well, which I said the blue-eyed boys of investors, like BPCL, and then take a plunge, because the philosophy was that, okay, government, as Honorable Prime Minister said, government should not be in business. It's no business of the government to be in business. So with that philosophy, you have to actually move forward in terms of this. And I think this new policy in redefining public sector participation in commercial enterprises, this is also in works along with that direction, that you have certain strategic sectors where you retain a certain level of participation, both in terms of, you know, market imperfection role, or national security issue, or sovereign functions at arm's length, or, too big a share to be parted with to create private monopolies. So all these issues, if you are dealing, and based on that, you retain some enterprises in the public, but then have the rest of them either consolidated or privatized. So it's like building up a privatization and consolidation pipeline going forward. But it is not that all the companies will come at one go and things. As I said, it has to be again conditioned with the way, but the roadmap will be clear that here onwards, you would have to. And therefore, that roadmap will also let us know that where the public sector companies are going to be retained, I think we focus a lot on their capital management and a lot on, you know, how we will increase their value. And that is one of our goals, that market positioning of our PSUs, going into, you know, looking at how to increase the value, how to improve the connect of the PSU management with the markets. We have found that some of the companies where the management is deeply engaged with the investors from time to time, their share values are good, investors are interested in them, and if we come out with the issues or IPOs or FPOs, I think there will be, you know, investors will be enthused. And here I would also like to point out that some people think that, you know, as if, you know, we are trying to manage our issues only to LICs and so on. Well, that's not true, because we have we found out that, you know, huge amount of, when we are doing our issues, LIC is now relatively minor player. It's a pretty, I mean, they just do it on their own stuff. So we don't have to just, you know, ring up LIC all the time and tell them, you know, you please subscribe. So the issues have to fly on their own merits. The companies have to fly on their own merits. And for that also, the company management need to change, and they also have to have, in fact, what we are suggesting change in the MOU conditions of those PSUs, where at least the management have a very clear idea of return on capital employed. I think we would like to have a target of return on capital employed for the management, so that they keep the shareholders in mind while they're trying. We would like to have a consistent dividend policy, so that, you know, the investors are, they know that, you know, that these dividends are going to come. So of course, many of the PSU stocks we found the dividend yield is very high, but still, you know, their the price to earning ratio, which is not good. So I mean, we have to see, you know, there are also a certain kind of a market perception about the PSUs in many a time, in which, you know, those market perceptions need to be corrected, because engagement process is there, more autonomy, more professional management. These are, of course, the issues where Deepam can actually persuade, like Champion, with the other departments, like administrative departments in the DPE, and we are trying to do that. As I said, the strategic disinvestment completion transaction, completing what we have done, is a quite a matter of priority, and also building up a healthy pipeline. And these are the kind of things with it. Then, of course, listing of unlisted enterprises. I said that there are, of course, not many are left out, actually. But as I said, the biggest one, the cat is now out of the bag with FM's announcement on LIC. I think this has been a very bold decision. And LIC is now, has to be prepared for that IPO. The process is already set into motion. We have already advertised the transaction advisor, pre-IPO advisor is being done to look at every issue which is there. There is a lot of preparation for this IPO, but it will be a very, very good step for the economy. Because in terms of LIC's own health, as well as availability of, you know, LIC's sharing of LIC's wealth with the investors, with the shareholders, in an IPO, would also be a very important beginning on this regard. So these are my comments, initial comments, and now I think, if you permit that, we can. I can close my remarks here, and then we can welcome questions. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. That was very comprehensive. In fact, I was looking at my chat box and the questions. It sounded to me that all those questions were presented to you directly, and you answered all of them in your presentation. So literally everything, and I'm clubbing like 10 questions, and these are from media as well as from the other participants. There's one other area which I think a number of people have talked about, and Rasesh did touch upon in the beginning, and said this before your session, We had the benefit of listening to the Chief Economic Advisor's view. He also mentioned about the importance of the large size bank, therefore the consolidation of the bank. I totally understand that there is another department of the government which is also involved in this, because that's the Department of Banking Commercial Services which is involved in this. Would you want to, because there are a number of questions which has come up here. I believe there was some announcement or some press around this today. Would you want to throw some comments on this one, on the banking sector consolidation, the large size bank, privatization of bank, all of that club together?
No, I mean, for example, FM also mentioned about the IDBI bank that was also announced in the budget. So IDBI bank typically today is listed as a private bank with 51% equity from LIC and about 47% of the government. This is and IDBI is to and that is already announced. So this is a company. So, and then of course there are other banks where under the Bank Nationalization Act or things like that, where legislative changes, etc., would also be necessary. But we are very closely working with the Department of Financial Services, and I think the general framework will be the same as FM announced, that what is the new policy which is really in works, which will be out soon. It will actually unveil, what is the kind of sectors that we are there. As I said, the crux of the policy is that private sector should be there in all sectors, including strategic sectors. So therefore, it is not that strategic sectors will be reserved for public sector. No way. That means even in some areas, of course, very, very limited areas now remain. Private sector is allowed everywhere now. Mm-hmm. Of course, there could be some specific legislation where a certain FDI limit is there or something is there. Or maybe if you do, and maybe in atomic energy or maybe in somewhere, even space, for example, there was an opening where private sector was going. So therefore, the idea is that if you have a strategic sector, private sector will be allowed in all the things. So it is not that on their own they can come. But if the existing public sector enterprises, you only retain some and balance could be privatized or consolidated. So therefore, the idea is that you are trying to give space to, more space to private sector in terms of brownfield investments of, once these, the enterprises, they are strategically privatized. So it is that basically, as I said, that creating that pipeline where you have, and I think once you have a stronger pipeline, the government does need resources. So therefore, I mean, this there's always of questions, that you have a fiscal and you have this target, then how are you, because the government also needs this. But at the same time, what we have to say is that we are actually selling at the right value, and we have got a healthier pipeline, and we have got some strategic disinvestments taking place on regular basis. So a certain number, because the strategic disinvestment actually does not disturb the market. In fact, it aids the market, because what it is basically doing is the control is getting passed on. The control is getting passed. Whereas when you are, repeated issues, if you are trying to do beyond a point, you are in any case will hit the limit. In order to remain public sector, you should have certain holdings, you keep on chipping out and you will hit the limit. So therefore, unless and until we build up, this kind of a second line, where we are able, and this second line should be revenue yielding. Because it can't be simply that, I can't manage or somehow you want to do that. That means I should get a good amount of money for my shares, which means that I should be selling the assets which the private sector and investors are willing to invest in, so that they will offer me the share value I am looking for. And therefore, I will get the receipts. But I will get the receipts by passing on to from public sector to private sector, it remains in our economy, it aids Atma Bharat because then it grows. So the idea is Atma Bharat means growth. You get into all the products, import substitution product, new technologies within the boundaries of India. It can be done through FDI, it can be done through domestic investors, but it has to be within the domestic thing. And for that to happen, I must provide not only the greenfield opportunities, but also the brownfield opportunities. And therefore, there is also an issue of more and more asset monetization. How does the different departments, they do the asset monetization? Because if they have certain idle assets, the departments, if they try to put those assets out to this thing, be it land, be it something other things, so that's something also being promoted, and so that the departments, they have a certain target and certain things of trying to do asset monetization, because certain amount of receipts also can come from asset monetization. But everything has to be related to the market. But if you have a healthier pipeline, number one, and secondly, greater capacity in the system to do things, and third, the greater engagement with the private sector and investors, so that they can come and pick up, they can come and bid. If I go out and bid, if I ask for an EOI, there should be, people should be responding. Yeah. So all these three things, if it happens in a healthier economy, then I think privatization of Indian economy will proceed at a much better pace. We will also get resources. I think that is the whole idea of this Atmanirbhar Bharat project.
So just clarifying, because there are a number of questions on this, that in this strategy which you articulated, which Honorable Finance Minister also articulated, where in the core sectors also privatization will happen, and government can take a view that some of the companies may continue to be under the government control, banking also falls under that, right? Because that's the question. Will there be a privatization in the banking sector also? So that's what a number of people are trying to ask.
No, I mean, as I said, that I would not jump the gun till, the whole approvals are in place. But okay. As I said, that if you can find out from what I said, it is a broader vision. It is not just restricted to, as I said, commercial enterprises. So it is not necessarily, it is restricted to A or B or C. It's a broader vision.
So there are a number of questions on oil and gas, PSUs and LIC, and also those who have addressed in any case, so HPCL, BPCL, ONGC, a number of questions. There's one completely differentiated, and I'll probably take that as a last question. I'm mindful of your time, we started a bit late. So there is one question, and the thought is that economic survey, which was presented pre-budget in different environment, had a full chapter on this investment privatization strategy and the methodology, and that was only a recommendatory in terms of a holding company structure and things like that. Is there any thinking of the government to pick up from there and think about or implement some of those?
No, I mean, we are looking into it, but I think we need to have a bit of a clarity on, holding company, what are the objectives?
Yes.
Now, you do a holding company when you have clear objectives. What do you want to do? So, if you do not have clear objectives, just merely, because, for example, Temasek model.
Yes.
Now, if you look at a Temasek model, there are certain pros and cons of that model. This model has developed over a long period of time. There has been a legislation. Through a legislation, this government equity has been transferred to Temasek institution. It is more like an investment vehicle. It is actually not a disinvestment vehicle. Because for your information, in Singapore, it is a completely different thing as compared to India. India, we always, give a lot of premium to privatization. We think that, privatization is a reform. Singapore doesn't think that way, because Singapore, whether it is Changi Airport or you have a Singtel or others, they are very much in the thing, and they think that they are, you know, like just like a private sector. So for them, you know, this public-private is completely, they look at the enterprises. But here we have a certain, you know, certain kind of a thing. We don't look at the enterprise, rather we look at it, you know, privatization per se is considered a reform, and because it adds value and others, and we have been also saying so. Because one of the reason is that in the public sector space, we have constrained ourselves too much. We have not been able to give the kind of autonomy. We have not been able to give the kind of a thing because of also the way courts have interpreted our constitution. Now, it doesn't happen in every country. In our country, in courts have interpreted PSU as an instrumentality of the state under Article 12. So therefore, the states, you know, the people can go into writs against that. Nobody can go to the writs in other countries against an ex enterprise. It's only a contractual thing. So, I mean, so therefore the point is that to a large extent, the public sector is also burdened, where we are trying to give. So one of the things is that we are saying is that we are also giving them more autonomy, Maharatna, Miniratna, giving more autonomy to the boards, trying to give them more decisions and others. Still, there will be a certain amount of constraint, as I said, by the interpretation of the courts also. So therefore we say that, you know, the privatization has a much less, you know, their hands are much freer. And therefore we are saying privatization will lead. In some other economy, it is a completely different story. So therefore, Temasek model is actually an investment model. They actually invest in private sector companies also and abroad as well. So, but here we have been also trying to have a vision where we are trying to privatize. So therefore, how it will gel, what will be the thing, so that we have to examine. If the objectives are clear, then only we can proceed further in a model, because it's not for any fashion thing. We have to say whether it suits Indian conditions.
Okay. We need to close. All good conversation has to finally end. Rasesh, why don't I turn to you if you want to make any closing comments? Any view, any observation, Rasesh? I'm not sure it's there. Okay.
Thank you, Sunil, and thank you, Mr. Pandey. It was very engrossing to hear you, and as Sunil said, we could have gone on and on, because there are so many nuances and dimensions to what DIPAM is trying to do, and the kind of perspective that you bring, you know, the all the angles and even the examples of other countries and all. It's actually, even for us who've been in the capital markets for a long time, it's actually very enlightening to see the various angles on these issues, whether it's the LIC disinvestment issue or the strategic privatization issue, or the role of DIPAM issue. And I think you have covered so many things in this that we have a lot more food for thought than even we expected. So I must say thank you very much for this really engrossing and enriching conversation. And we do hope that we'll get more opportunities to have this kind of conversations with you going forward. And we will be able to give you the feedback and the questions from the capital market, but also be able to learn from you on your perspective and approach.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Very good session.